The Emperor's Wine. A rosé by any other name would taste the same.
I love the story I read in Stephanie. She had noticed that wine connoisseurs seemed to have upper-class accents, as if tasting wine changed the structure of the vocal cords. It amused her, a good middle-class and middle-aged woman who had travelled extensively for her work. She had eaten the speciality foods of many countries and had drunk wine from the allegedly best to locally made wines that had love and affection in every sip. To her delight, she observed the folk who would look at the label first to appraise its cost, and then they would go through the pantomime that followed. Once in the glass, look at it, see the colours. Smell it. In the glass, while it is on a flat surface, lift it, swirl it, and then sniff again, and, at last, take a sip. Her father had grown up in the west of England and drank the product made from the local crops there, apples. She never saw him perform the routine with cider. He might sniff it briefly before pouring the golden, sometimes cloudy liquid into his mouth and feel it trickle down into his stomach. In London, the competition between wannabe alpha males was intense. It was not just about their money, it was also about cultural values, because they came from breeding and one's pedigree was as valuable as if they had been at a human crufts. They would go through the performance as dramatic and intense as an opera. Stephanie would attend a tasting at her friend's apartment when she wanted to cheer herself up by inwardly laughing at the players in the game.
"Oh, well, I bought this Medoc from a dealer who had stored in his cellar for 15 years. Cost a bomb, but it is wonderful. Have a taste,"
Ludlow stated to the small collection of ultra-rich guests. They looked, sniffed, swirled, sniffed, and sipped.
"Oh, I'm getting oak from a barrel, so a little bit of tannin. Well, I'm getting red fruits and roses. Yes, you're right, and I'm getting tobacco."
Cecil, always a believer that there was, is, and never should be any respect for women, looked at Stephanie. "How about you?" He sniffed not the wine, but with not very well concealed contempt. She tasted without all the rigmarole, after taking a sniff more to answer Cecil's tone than for the wine, and replied, "I get farmyard." They all sniffed and tasted, and had to agree.
"And I'm getting antique shop."
They again sniffed, tasted, and nodded their agreement.
"And now I'm getting the smell of leather in a brand new Mercedes."
She was making it up and chuckling at the puppet show where they dipped their heads to smell and then tipped them back to drink like the nodding, drinking duck toy. "Oh, wait a moment. Now I'm getting spices and herbs that describe the warm countryside where the wine was made." More nodding, sniffing and drinking, Stephanie struggled to keep a straight face.
"Ludlow, have you any other wines for us?"
He went to his wine cellar where he kept his collection at the recommended temperatures and returned with a bottle.
"I know it's only a South African wine, but your opinion would be welcomed."
Stephanie was puzzled that he had apologized. If their displeasure had been audible, the noise would have been deafening. The second act in the circus was about to begin. The tasters dismissed the quality of the wine by its label rather than by its smell or taste. They knew that the price of the best South African wines would not match the French ones.
"Sorry, Ludlow, I think this is not up to scratch, old boy. Where can we spit it out?"
Wigbert asked. A spit bucket was produced and used by all apart from Stephanie, who swallowed the excellent Shiraz she had in her glass.
"Sorry about that, chaps," Ludlow apologised again as if he had served arsenic. "I will get another bottle."
He returned with a Californian wine. The same thing happened, sipped and spat out. Stephanie liked hers, though. Ludlow was stuck. He wanted to present a global tour of wines, but his guests, bar one, were fixed on the most expensive-looking wines that he could offer. Another French wine, this time a Burgundy, was enjoyed by everybody apart from Stephanie, who used the spit bucket. It was too old and tasted awful. Ludlow told them that his show was over, and they should now taste the wines the guests had brought with them. Figgy was the first, with a Chablis that was excellent, but which should have been drunk before the reds. Ormerod was braver. He had an Australian red that was very drinkable, but lacked something that none of them could define, apart from Stephanie, who, in her head, thought a high price. Her mention of a hint of eucalyptus got them all sniffing, swirling, and sipping again. They started to like it better. Kenneth stuck out not just because he had a name without a price tag on it, but for the simple reason he had bought Rioja. The men remembered the cheap Spanish wine they used at parties in their youth to get drunk quickly.
"Got the oak in this one, by Jove, very nice." Ludlow wanted to mention the oak because his first bottle had been oaky and well received.
Nobody spat that one, and they took their time to discuss and evaluate the Spanish contribution. Then, last but not least, Stephanie produced her bottle. It was French, but the label did not shout expensive. It was poured, sniffed, swirled, you've got the message by now, and then they grimaced and spat it out. Stephanie sipped hers without comment. She poured more and sipped away. "Gentlemen, and otherwise, what did you get from that wine?" They were silent. Stephanie spoke up. "What I got from that was farmyard like the first wine, but this time I got a lot of bullshit. But it is coming from all of you. You see, my wine is exactly the same as the first one that Ludlow served, the only difference being that I asked a sommelier to gently change the label. You judged the book by its cover and rejected what you thought would make you look less than you would wish to be if you had just been honest. If you remember a story about the Emperor's new clothes, then I am glad to announce to you that I am the little boy who saw the truth." There was silence. Then she added to her speech. "A maker of excellent wine once replied to my question about what she thought a good wine is. She told me to taste it, and if I liked it, then it was good. If I did not like it, then it was a bad wine for me. Gentlemen, learn to be honest with yourselves and others rather than playing a game of snobbery." She turned on her heel and walked away, winking at Ludlow, who was in on her trick.